fear no one. These are the opening remarks of Jesus' address to us this morning. Fear no one. Tell somebody next to you, fear no one.
Fear no one.
I don't know whether you understand what you are saying, my dear sisters and brothers. Fear no one, yet in our world, we are afraid of people. We fear men, we fear women. Some of us fear even our husbands, our wives, our parents, our children. Some of us fear our police at the workplace, our bosses. And some of us even fear people who are working with us. You see, friends, fear is something that Christians should not tolerate. And Jesus has reminded us of that. Because he makes a statement. He says, do not be afraid of the person who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul. As you know, once upon a time, our bodies were created first. But the bodies were useless until God, we are told in Genesis chapter 1, breathed onto our bodies. We became a living soul. So that soul that we have in us is from God. And because it comes from God, it cannot be killed. It cannot be terminated. There is the God spirit in us. And for the body, how many years? Is it 70 or 80? And then it is gone. So there is something that comes today, tomorrow it is useless, if I can say. And the soul is what will live even after this body has expired. And Jesus is saying that we should rather be afraid of the one, again, who can destroy both soul and body. He mentioned a place, Gehenna. Gehenna was a place in Israel which was known to be always burning. This is the history of Gehenna, but it has a spiritual meaning now. It was a place where people used to dump unused waste, a huge kind of refuse site. So they go and dump them because that always they were burning the refuse. I think these days you have something like that. They were burning it. So anytime you went to Gehenna, there was fire there. Burning was taking place. And so that place was noted as a place where if you go, there was always fire. And so the Israelites were afraid of Gehenna. Jesus tells us that it's a spiritual Gehenna. Now we call it hell, where we know that after our life is ended, our lives are over, and we don't find our place with God. He says those who are not with him will find their place there in Gehenna. So it's a place of fire, a place of pain. Yet Jesus tells us that we are more than sparrows and our hairs have been counted. I have not tried counting my hairs, the hairs of my body. I have not tried. Maybe because it's not possible. I don't know those who are amongst us who are experts. Can we count the hair? No. You can't count them. And God is saying that each hair has been counted. You see, to count your hair will mean that you have to have time, patience, and even love. To take your time there, our ladies, when they go to do their hair, sometimes it takes time, because the person wants to give them a better look. And God is saying that he has counted your hairs, the number of your hairs, which means that he has so much time for you to go slowly, patiently, painstakingly, and he knows the number of your hair. And he said that not one of those hairs has been left aside. You see, this is a God we worship who loves us so much. They said that he knows even the little detail of your life. That's what God is saying. The small details of your lives, our lives that we think that they are not necessary for God. He says he's interested in even the smallest details of your life. Amen. If you have a God who has interest in the smaller details of your life, then you should be happy. And that's why he said, don't fear anybody. For he has taken care of every part of, every second of your life on earth. From the day we were born, even to the time he called us to heaven. And then here in the first reading, Jeremiah, one of the prophets who suffered so much. Suffering is something that Christians, human beings, wouldn't want because it comes with pain. Some of us suffer because of betrayal. Some of us suffer because of people lying against us. Some of us suffer because people taking advantage of us. Some of us suffer because people are cheating us. Some of us suffer because of our own problems. And Jeremiah the prophet suffered so much that he prayed, as we heard in the first reading, asking God to take care of his enemies. I want to mention three ways to handle suffering, and then I'll end the reflection. Number one, you are not alone. Amen. Tell somebody you are not alone. When you suffer, I want to remind that you are not alone. You are not alone. It will interest you know that whatever you are going through today, somebody has gone through before. Whatever you are going through now, somebody has gone through before. You are not the first person on this universe, in this earth, in this world to go through that. So you are not alone. But that is what I'm talking about. I'm saying you are not alone because Jesus, the one we worship, has gone through that before. Again, we go to Genesis. We hear that God created the Garden of Eden with no sin, with no suffering. Then men said, women said, Adam and Eve, they disobeyed God and suffering came. So we change this world, was a Garden of Eden, into a valley of tears. We say that in our prayers, valley of tears. So a place for happiness became a valley of tears. And yet God decided to come down into this valley of tears to taste our suffering. See, when you are a chef or you cook and you don't taste the food and give to people, you might not know what they are tasting. God, because he loved us so much, decided to taste what we are tasting. He's not a woman who cooks. He's not a man who cooks and then give the food that tasty, whether it is salty or not. No, he tastes it himself. So if you are complaining, he understands. And this is our God who has tasted our sufferings. He became human being, man, suffered on the cross. And the cross, we know, was a symbol of shame, a symbol of pain. The cross. So you are not alone, my dear sister. You are not alone, my dear brother, when you go through sufferings. You are not alone. Number two. See, if you look at the cross carefully, I don't know, I want to show you how to make a cross in your life. You see, just write a capital I on a paper and then cross it out. You get what? You get a cross. So a cross is anything that will come against you, the I, your selfishness, your pride. You see, these are the things that become for us crosses. Because the eye is there, but you want to turn, become have a cross in life, you have to cancel the eye. So many things you go through in this world, which become crosses to us, are things that make us become closer to God because we have canceled the selfishness of our lives. So the second point is, first know that every suffering will come to an end. If you read the story of Jesus going through the Calvary and going through the station of the cross, you think that the cross was going to be carried all his life. No. He had a point called Calvary where he laid down the cross. So your cross, your suffering will be forever. Your cross will come to an end, your suffering will come to an end someday. Amen. Let that be an encouragement. The fact that you are not going to suffer forever, let it give you the strength to carry on. The last one. Jesus has the answer. Recently, I've been praying with this hymn. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Hymn 259 of our Kali hymn now. It says, all our sins and grief to bear, what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. So Jesus has the answer to our sufferings because if you carry everything to him in prayer, take care of it. Listen to some lines of this hymn. Can you find a friend so faithful with all your sorrows share? Jesus knows your every weakness, your every pain. Take it to him in prayer. And then the last one says, do your friends despise? Do your friends forsake you? Again, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms, he will take and shield you. And you find a solace there. My dear friends, the hymn says, take everything to God in prayer. Sometimes we take some things to God and we need certain things for ourselves. Jesus has the answers. Take everything to Him in prayer. Prayer is the key to every pain, every suffering. Things you don't understand that happen to us, take it to the Lord in prayer. And He Himself will give you solace, rest for our souls. Amen.